The continents of Europe and Asia are joined by a land bridge 700 miles wide, bordered by the Black Sea to the west and the Caspian to the east. But across this bridge there runs a barrier, the Caucasus Mountains. Some of the peaks are over 18,000 feet high, the highest mountains in Europe. Very few are the passes that cut through this barrier, yet along these paths the early Asiatic civilizations tried again and again to make their way northward into Europe. We are now south of the Caucasus, in Soviet Armenia. Shepherds still drive their flocks over the sparse arid fields, as they have done for centuries. For in this hot, dry country, sheep require less food and water than do cattle, especially such sheep as these. See those enormously oversized tails? Some of them weigh 70 pounds or more, all solid fat. So that in times of scarcity, a sheep can exist literally by living off its own tail. The sheep are driven to market, which, as in many ancient cities, is held just outside the walls that completely surround the towns for defense against marauders. This is the town of Echmiadzin, E-C-H-M-I-A-D-Z-I-N. Famous throughout antiquity as the hometown of Noah, who built the ark. Many of the scenes have hardly changed since Noah's time. The blacksmith prepares a set of shoes for an ox, much better suited to this climate as a beast of burden. No, the ox is not being hurt or tortured. It's just the way that oxen have been shod here through centuries. Inside the walls, the dusty, unpaved streets are lined with straight rows of houses that all seem to look alike. It's hard to imagine that behind these monotonous fronts, there are little walled gardens where the family lives much of its home life. Irrigation water runs through open ditches, for without water, gardens will not grow, and the little boys can't go swimming. This monastery inside the town claims to be the oldest in the world. It is the seat of the Catholicus, who heads the Armenian church, just as the Pope heads the Roman. This venerable priest is the secretary to the Catholicus. In his hands is the most historic relic of this monastery, framed in gold, and the cross upon it is set in large gems, a genuine piece of Noah's Ark, so it is claimed, the only piece of petrified wood ever found on Mount Ararat. The relics of another religion and another civilization long forgotten are found on a hilltop nearby. And in the distance, we see Mount Ararat, where Noah's Ark is supposed to have settled after the flood. In all probability, this was yet another outpost of yet another conqueror who set out to rule the world by crashing the gates of the Caucasus, and whose very name is today forgotten. How we wish we could have transcribed the cuneiform carvings on these great tablets. They probably tell us the whole story. Going northward now, we reach the Armenian town of Delijan. Here we find representatives of many nations. This man is a Persian on his way to market. Perhaps he is on his way to Tiflis, capital of the Transcaucasian Soviet Republic. A relatively modern town that even has street guards. Joseph Stalin, Russia's war premier, grew to manhood here. The open-air public market is as old as the town itself, and we find here a mixture of types of all coins, merchants, beggars, and even priests. In Tsarist days, all priests were paid by the state. Now they are supported by their own congregations and denominations, as in most Western lands. In the market we find not only peddlers, but also craftsmen like these cobblers. North from Cyprus runs the only really good road that spans these mountains, the so-called Georgian military highway. In the more sheltered valleys beside rushing mountain streams, we find good-sized villages like Kazbek, nestling at the foot of the mountain of that name. These are old towns. We still see their stone watchtowers in which guards were posted to warn of the approach of enemies. Life was hard in these mountains, and a large part of the activity of the men was given over to raiding and to beating off raids. The mountaineers live largely from their flocks. During the summer, there is plenty of grazing land in high mountain meadows, but the snow falls early and the winter is long, and this greatly cuts down the number of animals and people that a given area will support. So tribal warfare was the natural order of life. There are over 200 different languages spoken in the Caucasus by these tough, freedom-loving fighters, and it was only when the Russians in 1769 forced their way through these passes with cannon and began the great road that took almost 100 years to build that the individual tribes yielded to superior power and became unwilling parts of the Russian Empire. The road is one of the greatest engineering feats of all time. The ancients speak of locking these passes with metal and masonry gates as early as 5,000 years ago, and of defiles so narrow that a few men could hold an army at bay. It's still anything of the boot, but it's safe and solid, even when we have to ford a river occasionally. What a job the ancient armies must have had in trying to get through here before there was any road at all to make grades easy enough for automobiles to take in high gear. In the winter, the snow gets 30 feet deep and more in some of these passes, so that the road is protected with special snow tunnels, especially at points where avalanches are most common. Many of these small, independent, and widely differing settlements were left stranded in the mountains during the invasions and migrations from the south. But one of the most remote of mountain peoples certainly seems to have had a unique origin. We are going quite a bit out of our way to visit them, high in the mountains. Hevsurs, K-H-E-V-S-U-R-S, they are called. And one of the most interesting things about them is that they are thought to be the descendants of a band of crusaders driven far off their path en route to or from the wars in the Holy Land. The men probably fought their way inland, intermarried with women of the tribes they conquered, and finally settled in the high country. Here they live off their flocks, pasturing them out in the fields in summer, and in winter they shelter them on one of the floors of their three-storied houses that they build right against the mountain, half inside and half outside. The family lives on the next floor. The third floor is used for a storeroom and a lookout platform. Each little cluster of houses is a separate family clan, the members of which stick together through thick and thin, for against any outsider, no member of the family can do anything wrong. Ordinarily, visitors are viewed with suspicion, but our guide is a good friend of this family, so they welcome us and offer us food from their community kettle. Water is hard to get, so very little is wasted in washing. The fuel is scarce, too, and since they burn cow dung, the air gets pretty bad at times. They are a self-reliable, fearless people and make practically everything they need for their living with their own labors. These fancy blouses are hand-woven by the women, who do a large part of the hard work. Now, you know, they marry young, but they age quickly. We see traces of their origin in the blue eyes, ruddy skin, and sometimes even blonde hair. This little fellow doesn't care to have his picture taken. But a looking glass has the same effect on children in any language. Like all children, these youngsters want to face the camera if there is any picture taking going on. Well, they finally turn around, and on their backs the Christian cross is woven right into their jackets. They know very little about Christ, however, and the prevailing religion is somewhere between the old shaman devil worship and the Russian Orthodox faith. But here is still clearer evidence. In practically every household there are treasured weapons and coats of chain mail, such as were worn by crusading men-at-arms. These coats still figure in the astounding system of blood feud that is practiced here. If anyone injures or kills a member of a family and fails to pay satisfactory damages, the aggrieved next of kin must put on this mail and take up the ancient sword and go out to punish the aggressor. Two Hefsirs consented to reenact for us what would be likely to happen when adversaries met, but they would not agree to put on their coat of mail in fun. They have iron shields decorated also with the sign of the cross and used to protect the hands of the warrior as he holds his long two-handed sword. The Hefsir is short and wiry, like most mountain people. With his long dagger or king gowl on a stout leather strap and with his steel shirt, he is a tough fighting man. See the cross? It's unmistakable. The spirit of the Crusaders was not crushed, even by the great Caucasian barrier. People who live hard, frugal lives, up where the free winds blow and the storm clouds roll, never make good slaves.